The best modern book on natural selection in the wild is by John Endler, and he gathers together the then available evidence in 1986 on natural selection in field work. Endler himself did work on guppies, little fish, in mountain streams in Trinidad and Venezuela. These guppies live in these ponds, these pools, that are separated from lower pools and higher pools by waterfalls. And these fish can't normally move up a waterfall, but they can presumably move down, but they can't move up. But in flood years, the lower pools may become sufficiently high that they can get into, they can climb up the ladder of pools in some cases. Now, Endler and his colleagues made the observation that in certain places above a waterfall there were guppies but no predators, and below a waterfall there were guppies and predators. And in the place where there were guppies and predators, the guppies were all very drably coloured. But in the pool where there were guppies and no predators, the guppies were all bright coloured, like peacocks. Like peacocks, because this was sexual selection, the other great theory of Darwinian evolution. They were naturally selected, male guppies were naturally selected by females who liked their bright colours. But in the pools where there were predators, the predators found it easier to find the brightly coloured males and so ate them, so there was a counteracting selection pressure against bright colours. This was the observation that Endler made. How could he test it experimentally? How could he test experimentally the theory that it was indeed the predators that were providing the selection pressure that made the difference between the brightly coloured guppies where there were no predators and the drably coloured guppies where there were predators? Well, he did it both in the lab and in the field. In the lab was a large greenhouse, and he set up a series of 10 artificial ponds in the greenhouse, and he gave gravel bottoms. They all looked exactly the same as each other, except that in some ponds there were predators and in other ponds there were not. In all the ponds they were allowed, the guppies were allowed to breed freely. 14 months later, which is 10 guppy generations, the populations in the ponds with no predators were indistinguishable from each other. They were all brightly coloured with conspicuous spots, and the populations in the ponds where there were predators were all drab in colour. That was an experimental test. What about a field test? Endler took guppies from natural pools below waterfalls, which had predators and were all drab in colour, and he transplanted these guppies into a virgin pool above a waterfall where there were no guppies and no predators. So he found a completely empty pool where there were no fish of any kind. He took drab guppies from a pool where there were predators, and he fished the guppies out and put them in the pool where there was nothing, and then just waited to see what would happen. He came back 2 years later and found a definite measurable shift in the guppies towards bright coloration. They hadn't gone all the way yet, but they were definitely brighter. 9 years later still, a colleague called David Resnick revisited Endler's experimental pool and found that they were much more brightly colored. Evolution had taken place before their very eyes in the field over a mere 11 generations. John Endler was...
How many guppy generations?
About the same, I think slightly more. But it was of the order of the same number of generations. It was 11 years, I think it was, and I forget which way it goes for the generations. John Endler was once riding in a plane in continental United States, and he got talking to his next-door neighbour in the plane. And the next door neighbor asked him what he did, and Endler told him the story I've just told you, but he never mentioned either the word evolution or natural selection. But he told the story of the experiments and what they showed. And then the man said, that's really interesting. That's amazing. That's wonderful. There must be some kind of theory underlying all that. And only then did Endler reveal his hand and say, yes, it's called Darwin's theory of evolution by natural selection. And the man turned away and said, I don't believe in that. Turned away and terminated the conversation immediately. That, ladies and gentlemen, is what we're up against.